Welcome to Anatomy of Algebra. I'm Chris Holden. In this, our first episode, one I'm calling Just a Bit of Regular Old Algebra, I'm going to start out with something totally ordinary and basic, and yet still unmistakably algebra. This equation up here, something that you might find on any algebra test anywhere, something so ordinary actually hides plenty of secrets. Today, I'm going to unpack this cultural artifact a little bit so we can start to see how the mathematical now came to be. With just a few simple questions, we'll quickly dig deep into what algebra is. We'll also see that this process could keep going. The questions we start with today can lead to new questions and new paths to take. Because this first bit of algebra today is so elementary, we won't spend a lot of time with details of calculation. If you're here for heavier math, don't worry. We'll get there. If you're worried that the math might quickly get too hard, also, don't worry. Even as this hill gets steeper, we'll be in it together. So let's get back to our problem. What are some things that we notice about this right away? The word solve, this imperative direction that we're often given math problems, the numbers, the letter X, some other symbols, the minus sign, the equal sign. And then the thing that the equal sign tells us is that the thing that we're looking at as a whole is something called an equation. Each of these seemingly simple things can tell us a story. In speaking with people who've done algebra at some point in their lives, the letter X is the thing that they most often remember. It's nearly synonymous for them with the word algebra. People often describe X as the unknown, the thing you solve for, or sometimes just the variable. Generally, I'll call X a symbol, meaning a sign that stands in for something. The equal sign and the number signs are symbols too, but they don't get noticed as such very often. They're not actually the things themselves, but we usually treat them this way. Kind of like how, in most contexts, we treat written words made of letters as the idea itself, not a representation of that idea. The other major thing that people will remember about algebra is the activity of solving. Solving is a game you play with the player X, where the equal sign divides the field. The goal is to get X alone on one side. Most people prefer the left. There are rules to be followed about how one is allowed to get there. Most people, if asked to define algebra, they would answer something along these lines. Algebra is the game of solving equations for X. Like other games, like Sudoku, crosswords, or Rubik's Cube, this game has a structure that actually appeals to people for the most part, even if math generally has a pretty dodgy reputation. There's a concrete goal, a real sense of satisfaction to be had from winning, a feeling that the game of moving numbers and X's is this physical sort of concrete thing. In this one way, algebra seems like the kind of game you can enjoy on its own without being promised something good in life for being good enough at it. We can look at some of its design features that detract from its success, but to start, as a game, solving equations isn't half bad. I chose this first algebra problem because it so neatly encapsulates all the things most people who take algebra seem to pick up about it, even long after the last test is over. As such, it's a good foothold for asking the questions that never seem to come up about math. Questions like, why are we solving this particular equation? Why bother? And who cares? So our first step is going to be to take a little bit of a look at where a question like this actually comes from. To get started, the things that we've just noticed, these symbols and equations, had to be invented and come into use at some point. They came from some when and somewhere. To get farther, though, we need to be a little bit more specific about the questions we're asking. Here's three possible ones. First, when and where did people start using letters and symbols when doing math? Two, why do we use X as our first choice for our symbol when we do math? Three, when do we start thinking about solving problems in terms of winning the equation game? You might want to also think right now, what other questions you have? How could you make this line of inquiry more specific? Go ahead, stop, write a few questions down if you can. We also might be wondering about the larger question. The reason we use symbols and equations to do algebra today comes most directly from their slowly evolving use in Italy in the 1500s. Victor Katz leads us back to a group of people called the Italian abacists. These Italians put together two main things. First, a number system, usually called Hindu-Arabic numerals, recently imported to Europe from the Arabic world, but which originated in India, likely in the early centuries CE, and maybe even before that in China. And then the second thing that these Italian abacists put together were methods of algebra already in use in the Arabic world, sometimes under the name of Islamic or rhetorical algebra. So these abacus led directly to new generations of problem solvers adopting these methods in Italy and elsewhere in Europe, taking on harder problems, and along the way beginning to show some of the symbolic approaches we take for granted today. Okay, you might be saying, hold on a sec. It seems dumb to be leading you back to where things started, and yet we end up in a place where there's already something called algebra. There's a reason for this, though. What's usually called Islamic algebra did not look like the equation like there that we started with. Everything was written out in words, sentences, and paragraphs, even the numbers. At this point for us, I describe the situation of Islamic algebra as being able to do a lot of the problems that we call today algebra, as well as most of the sort of game of solving approach to things, so that we might honestly say that they already had equations, even though the symbol and graphic representation that we think about there wasn't in play. They also had and used the Hindu Arabic numerals that I just mentioned as part of this calculation and problem solving apparatus. We'll need to pay a little bit more attention to the role that numbers and calculations play in this business, and we'll wait till we know a little bit more about what's going on to take that super seriously. For now, we simply note that this is a part of the story. Like a lot of important inventions, the real importance of symbols and equations were not fully anticipated by their authors or at the time they were invented. Also, this change did not happen overnight or with a single individual, even though it's customary in history texts to try and identify a single point where the world changed. Instead, what happened is what started out as individual abbreviations, things like using a C for the Italian word cosa, meaning thing, and using that to refer to an unknown quantity, things like this gradually became shared and more symbolic over time. The operations and relations were likewise abbreviated and then started to be treated as things more than words. The other part of what was going on was a movement, larger than mathematics proper, to adopt Hindu Arabic numerals in commerce, record keeping, engineering, stuff like that, using symbols where previously words would have been used. Like I said, we don't usually notice that that thing right there isn't really a three, it's in fact a symbol. At this time, there was a push to both write three instead of sit writing three, T-H-R-E-E, and there was a resistance to that push. People eventually realized that the operations in algebra could likewise be treated symbolically, and they would seem to be closely related to the more abstract and symbolic version of numbers and arithmetic that were gaining in popularity as well. Another thing that happened at this time is that some operations, written as symbols, began to look like numbers and arithmetic could be applied to them as well. We take for granted today that multiplying x by itself gives you something x squared, something that we use a number to write. Something like this. We use a number there, but they didn't used to. We can develop an arithmetic of exponents and imagine any possible number as an exponent. So you and me, we would be very comfortable writing something like that, because that's a slot where a number can go. But that's a relatively modern, advanced idea. In the old days, they would have just written XX. It would also be much more common to literally call the thing a square. The connection between algebra and geometry was so strong, in fact, that in most contexts, something like X to the fourth even, something that seems very simple to us, was simply unthinkable, because it outstripped the number of dimensions that physical space had. One of the other things that symbols do for us, especially once we can use them to represent not just unknown, but also known quantities, which we usually call constants or coefficients, is that one can describe a procedure generally without needing to use a specific example. Think about all the letters that come up in the quadratic formula that you no doubt have been forced to memorize. But again, all of this innovation didn't happen at once or just in one place. None of these efforts were entirely grouped together under the program of introducing equations, symbols, or redefining algebra. It's partly only from us looking backwards, specifically with the question about where symbols and equations come from, that allow us to really identify these works and these ideas as coming together and being separate from others at the time. The simple equation that we started with, 3x minus 7 equals 15, is a little bit of a red herring too. Symbols and equations came out of a desire to deal with more complicated things than this, especially things like cubic equations. So like x cubed plus x equals 500. We can see the fruit of these innovations in our simple example, but we run the risk of misrepresenting the need for them without at least mentioning that they were introduced to deal with harder problems that were on the minds of these Europeans at the time. In the next section, I'd like to talk about some of the specific names and works and milestones along the way, starting with long paragraphs, full sentences, on the way to this sort of representation here.